This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today, we have a new guest on Dreamland, David Metcalfe, who is certainly one of the most remarkable and eclectic people I have ever met in terms of his understanding and his exploration of the edge of reality. David is so extraordinary that I'm going to have to ask him if he can start by trying to explain himself, because I can't explain him at all. All I could say is, folks, get set for what has got to be a great ride with a very special and remarkable man. Before we go on, I want to say that his website is David Metcalfe with an E, WordPress.com. And I think I will start out with a question, David. You talk on your website, exploring the outer edges of society and mind, the liminal analytics approach to research. Now, I think of the word liminal as meaning barely perceptible. So where are we here? Welcome to Dreamland, Guy, by the way.
Yeah, thank you so much. This is wonderful, Whitley. I'm really honored.
I'm so delighted to have you.
So yeah, liminal analytics. I've had a very strange life, and liminal analytics came out of an opportunity that I saw to bridge what had become my professional life in terms of marketing and communications at kind of an agency and nonprofit level. And some of the skill set that I developed working in that realm and bring that into what my background was, which was comparative religions and comparative cultural studies and cognitive philosophy. So theory of mind and, just looking into and delving into why we believe what we believe and why we perceive what we perceive and, what makes up our identities. And so, liminal analytics was almost a joke in the sense that you think of analytics in the business sense, and it's like business intelligence and, communication and kind of marketing concepts of analyzing markets and customer base and demographics. But all of those skills, when I started to look at parapsychology and anomalistic studies, I realized that I could quickly bring those in to those realms, bring my business skills into those realms, not in terms of marketing a product or, doing demographic studies, in the traditional sense, but in terms of actually looking at the phenomena itself, right? And so when I initially started it, I thought of, I was really inspired by William S. Burroughs had a comment about writing yourself into history and writing yourself into reality. And so liminal analytics became the vehicle for that. And I thought of my clientele not as being necessarily people, but what if you created an agency whose clientele was the liminal realm, right? And so it's a sort of the other. What if the other was your clientele? And I've kind of operated on that that basis throughout the years. It's been a little over a decade. So
you've come to a certain point with the other as your clientele, and folks, this is available on David's website. The sources will keep their secrets. Excuse me, folks. I'm getting a little cough today. Hopefully, I don't have COVID. I'm fully vaccinated, but I'm not sure how much that means now. The saucers will keep their secrets.
Yeah.
You say that at a time when the threat assessment, preliminary threat assessment, after 70 years or more of study, is just coming out.
Yeah.
So this preliminary threat assessment, which has been preliminary certainly since the time of General Nathan Twining, whose Twining memo in 1947 described objects moving in exactly the same way that we see in the videos that have been posted on by the New York Times and others, and are described in the threat assessment. So what gives? 70 years or a few years? What's going on here?
Yeah, and that was kind of the, so that t-shirt, the image on it came out of a joke between Greg Bishop and I. Greg Bishop, who wrote Project Beta and has the Radio Mysterioso podcast.
And who is one of the most brilliant podcasters out there. He's been on Dreamland, folks.
Yeah.
And I've been on his show too. We're great friends. So go ahead.
Yeah, and we have been talking about it, you know, and just seeing what was kind of the lead up conversation to the report coming out, you know, it wasn't touching on the phenomena, and you know, you've used the word the presence, you know,
yes,
none of that was coming out. And so we had this, you know, kind of running joke between us of the saucers will keep their secrets. Whatever's going to be in this report, it's not going to be the actual experience of people who have contacts. It's not going to be the history of the topic. And, you know, I think that's played out since the preliminary reports come out. You know, it really touches on nothing that anyone who has any familiarity with this topic. You know, and as you said, you know, I started to look at I really enjoy kind of comparative media studies, and you know, there were headlines coming out that were headlines that were in 1967 being published. Some of the headlines coming out now were exactly the same. You know, there was a Look magazine piece about the first time the Pentagon took UFOs seriously, 1967. You know. And it's just,
we're kind of going in circles.
Yeah.
And the saucers do keep their secrets. Yeah. And isn't that kind of the bottom line, David? They tell us nothing.
Right. It's a search, you know. And I think that's kind of a core to the experience, right?
Right. Well, yeah. I mean, I live in the experience all the time. I have my last missing time experience was a couple of weeks ago. And
right.
I don't know what the dickens they are at all. They've been actively engaged with me for 30 years, and I don't know what they are.
Well, and what's interesting too, I think that in your experiences, the lessons, right? It's not a objectified thing that you can just point to and say, you know, well, this is the answer. This is the thing. It's this conversation that goes on, you know, and I think that's one of the important things about your work is that people can follow that conversation, even pre-communion, they can follow that conversation that's been happening as this presence has interacted with you, you know, through fiction, through Wolfen and the Hunger and the books prior to communion, you know, and then the communion experience. And then after that, that quest for you know, trying to figure out answers in that. And how much richer is that than, you know, finding a machine flying in the sky that you can back engineer and turn into a fancy plane or a weapon, you know?
Well, a weapon is what they definitely want. And
yeah,
you know, when I think about that, my work, the first book, The Wolfen are the greys.
Right.
They're the greys. The second book, The Hunger, the beautiful blonde vampire is the blondes. Supposedly so benevolent, but I've met some of them and they're pretty creepy, I have to tell you. Just like, I like the greys, but in different ways. And then there comes a book about mind control called Black Magic.
Right.
A book about secret societies called The Night Church. And then it goes on to suddenly this, as it seems that the phenomenon is kind of circling me and getting closer and closer to my conscious awareness. I then write a book about the dangers of nuclear war, which turns out to be a huge issue in the phenomenon. And then a book about the environment, which is another, their other huge issue in this thing. And then the last book I wrote before the whole explosion happened in my life was called Cat Magic. And what was it about? It was about Wicca and the fairy faith and the fairy folk. And you have, you know, you have in that a whole unconscious response to the phenomenon.
Right.
You know, I hadn't actually thought of that in that terms until you brought it up just now. I knew, I thought about the wolf and the hunger, but I'd never put the whole thing together.
Yeah, it's
something like that. Mean how much of our society is influenced in this way, David, do you think? You must have been.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I think that that was one of the things that drew me into becoming more serious about engaging, you know, on the media end in terms of writing and that kind of thing and research. It drew me in the sense that I had had experiences ever since I was a kid. And part of that, though, was a sort of odd synchronistic strain that went through my life where, you know, I had teachers in high school encouraging me to read alchemical texts as part of like an AP English program. And it just so happened that that particular teacher, her husband was a lapidary scientist at the Institute of the Oriental Institute in Chicago. And he, you know, so she had sort of a background in medieval cultures and that kind of thing. And she had sort of guided me in some of the independent study kind of stuff I was doing in high school to engage with that topic. And I did a report in high school on the symbol of the dragon in alchemy, you know, which was, which, you know, you don't normally get a chance to do that. But what was odd was then I go to college, and another teacher that had connections to the Oriental Institute taught a summer semester on white magic and a summer semester on black magic. And her specialty was, she was an Assyrian, like she studied ancient Assyria and healing traditions. And so, you know, it was just, it was very sort of throughout my life, I've had these opportunities to engage with scholars and experiencers and that, all kind of following the same kind of, you know, conversation, not in terms of a written, you know, body of work, but in terms of conversations that I've had and meeting people. And that really started to intensify and get focused around 2009. When I started talking to Mac Tonies online. And talking to Mac Tonies made me realize that there was an opportunity to explore these areas and write about it, you know? And that was where I kind of got the idea to bring my skill set from working in communications and marketing and business and start to build, you know, a platform where I could have these kind of conversations on a more structured level. But what was interesting, you know, in tying all of that kind of together was when your book with Jeffrey Kripal came out, The Supernatural, I had some intense experiences of realization with you had a conversation with Mike Cloud.
Yes.
It was a podcast with Mike Cloud, and Mike was talking about starting his blogging and doing, you know, kind of digital media stuff in 2009. And I think Mac Tonies came up in the conversation. And when that happened, I had this moment where I realized that in 1987 was a key point in my life where my family had moved from Chicago to Arizona. And because we were moving at the time, my parents had taken me into a lot of bookstores to kind of keep the, you know, the kid, keep the kid busy, you know.
Kid fed.
Yeah, keep.
Yeah, keep. Like me.
So
there's so many of us.
Right. So I would be in these bookstores, and what was there in 1987? It was the major push for communion. So that cover, right? When you were talking to Mike, and the mention of Mac Tony's in 2009, which was when I started a blog called The Eyeless Owl, and Mike had started blogging about owl synchronicities, and
right.
The Eyeless Owl was what kind of allowed me to get deeper into writing and to get published and that kind of thing. So I had this weird kind of time slip moment where my entire timeline, you know, I guess what Eric Wargo would call, like, you know, the fourth dimensional me, right? That stretches yeah. back in time. It suddenly connected where I was there as the kid standing there looking at the communion cover, you know, and having this experience and realizing that it had influenced me, you know, in terms of writing in that. So it was, you get pulled into this thing. And I really like that term that you've used recently, the presence, because it really is a presence.
It's much more diffuse. I wouldn't call it the visitors anymore. It is a presence. I think that's the most meaningful phrase. Go ahead.
Yeah. And I, you know, diffuse, exactly. People want this concrete, like, you know, a UFO flies down and you have contact with an alien walking out of it or something. But the phenomena and this presence and this experience is so much more integral to our being, you know. And I think that is, again, another important thing that's being missed right now, is just how integral this is. You know, in your question of how common is it for, you know, these kind of things in fiction and that, you know, and I think that's one of the exciting things about Jeff's work in, you know, mutants and mystics and that, and even the supernatural, yeah. is studying how culture is built on this, you know, or Diana Pasulka's work.
This issue of how culture is built on it. Oh, by the way, folks, before we go on, I want to mention that David mentioned Eric Wargo. Eric has been on Dreamland twice, in 2011 and in, let me see here, I'm looking at it, in 2011 and in 2018 and 2021. I'm sorry, I was misreading it. So subscribers, you can listen to those two shows, and they're particularly wonderful. There's one called Precognitive Dreamwork, Interpreting Messages from Our Future Lives, which is just a unique show. You won't ever hear. Unfortunately, Mac Tonis was never on Dreamland, and he died rather suddenly.
Yeah.
He also had an iffy relationship with me. But if I was had trouble with people with iffy relationships with me, I would be almost alone in the world. I didn't bother. Bud Hopkins had an even iffier relationship with me, and I didn't. I made Bud furious, and I didn't do it on purpose. And my wife used to say, you know, Whitley, you do understand you actually probably are the most annoying person in the world. And she was married to me, so she didn't know. But in any case, that doesn't bother me. And we're going to take a little break for our free Dreamlanders right now. And when we come back, we're going to get a little bit more into, we're going to sort of pick a brief side road down the Mac Tonis trail, because it's an interesting trail to follow. And then we're going to circle back, and David is going to come clean to us about some of these experiences he referred to, and why in the world a teacher would be asking a high school student to study alchemical texts. All right, free Dreamlanders, we'll be right back.
Unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago, Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
We're talking to David Metcalfe. This is David's first time on Dreamland, and he's here because he's obviously a really extraordinary person. Period. His website, which is equally extraordinary, is davidmetcalfe.wordpress.com, where you can learn about liminal analytics, and we're going to get into things like the threat assessment more deeply later on. And you can actually get this fabulous t-shirt, which I got two of them to give, one to give to my brother and one to give, I guess, to maybe my grandson, I don't know. The saucers will keep their secrets. David, just before we left the air, we were going to talk about Mac Tawney's. Can you tell us a little bit about who he was and why his approach was so important?
Well, Mac, so the way that I ran into his work was actually on Twitter. And what was interesting in 2009 was sort of the really sort of coalescing of what we think of as social media now. And Mac was someone who was doing, you know, Fortean and anomalistic research, paracultural research. But he was also blogging in a really personal, honest, and direct way, and was just kind of laying it all out there. So he would go from, you know, theorizing about crypto-terrestrials and you know, John Keel and all these topics, and then go into what he was eating. it was just a very personal kind of way to approach it. And so, you know, I started talking to him in that. And actually, you know, as you pointed out, he passed away rather suddenly. And
yeah, very much so.
He became the focus of a documentary. He was one of the people that a documentarian from, I believe, New York had chosen to focus on in terms of the relationships that he built. And the documentary was on, this again was when social media had really started to coalesce. And it was on what happens to our digital selves when, you know, the physical body goes away and you have this sort of leftover digital body of relationships. And I did some illustrations of kind of like, I've got one here. This is sort of a UFO illustrations.
That fits the gestalt of Mac perfectly. I have to tell you, you didn't know Mac folks probably, but he had an air about him of danger and suppressed knowledge that was fascinating. Go ahead.
And so some of my illustrations ended up in the documentary, and I had a chance to kind of participate in that. And it was a very sort of odd, you know, kind of thing. And, you know, his work, obviously, he had relationships with a lot of different people and was sort of this bridge figure in these topics coming over into social media. And I often look back on that time, you know, with some nostalgia and sadness, because there was an honesty and directness that he offered that, you know, I think things have become so mediated now, and people have, you know, it's very personally branded, and they have this.
Also a fascinating thing called Mac Tony's Interviews and Quotes, Whitley Strieber, which folks, if you should, would really enjoy, I think. Now, is the documentary, isn't it called Mac Tony's and the Crypto Terrestrials?
No, it was it wasn't about his paranormal stuff. It was about him as just a person.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was really interesting. And she did a couple other people that I don't remember the documentarian's name, but she had done a couple other people who passed away during that time, and sort of what the effect on culture was going to be when we had these relationships with strangers, you know, and once they left, like, what would that mean? You know,
Mac's take on me was not very flattering, but in any case, it was still fascinating, and I thought brilliant. And in spite of the fact that I disagree with everything negative he said about me, it's absolutely blanket disagreement.
You've sparked much controversy over the years in terms of interpreting your life for you. You know, it's fairly odd, you know, and this is one of the things that along the lines of what these digital others and these long distance kind of relationships that we all sort of have now with this. And I think people who've been in the media have had this longer. But, you know, I find it odd. Some of my friends, like Joseph Matheny, who did Ankh's Hat, when I see people, especially podcasters and bloggers, writing about Joe as this sort of conspiracy figure or MKUltra handler or any of this stuff, it's really weird to me, because I've known him, you know, for about a decade now. And I know that none of that stuff is true. And they'll create these whole, you know, storylines about what Joe's done and what he meant when he did Ankh's Hat and all this stuff. And it's really odd to know him as a person and to see this, you know, whatever this sort of artificial creation is in other people's minds, you know. And I'm sure it, for you, it's even stranger to read yourself portrayed in ways, you know.
Yeah, really strange. Yeah, I'm no good at conspiracies. My idea of being a spy would be to sneak around on your tiptoes in an overcoat. That's not the type, you know. But it reminds me also of John Alexander. Colonel Alexander was the head of the Army's non-lethal weapons program. Bill Cooper, in his book "Behold a Pale Horse," has a memo supposedly from John Alexander to God knows only who about me and Richard Hoagland, who was the science reporter on Art Bell's Coast to Coast for many years and still has his own blog, and I believe in also his own podcast, that we hit. It's a memo showing that that we were activated in some way. And what could it mean? And yet Bill Cooper published this, and he made it up. I mean, so you're right, these things are just made up out of thin air by people and then believed implicitly by thousands.
Yeah, it becomes part of the cultural narrative, you know, and it's unfortunate, you know, because a lot of times it's people who put a lot of work into trying to understand this stuff suddenly become wrapped up in these fictional narratives. And it, you know, it really, I think it takes away from, you know, any opportunity that people would have to explore the topic deeper, you know. And in this, yes, a lot of the stuff too is, even if true, so much of it isn't even taken at an objective level that could be functional, you know, even if the if part of the conspiracy theory is true, you know.
And part of a lot of them are true. I mean, I know of a lot of conspiracy theories that aren't quite true.
Yeah.
But at the same time, when you got, you know, I had an email from someone who was very angry at me because I hadn't embraced QAnon. And she was saying, well, how could you possibly believe in the UFO cover up and not QAnon? And, you know, that's a huge leap. It's a huge leap.
Yeah.
She didn't see it that way. She saw all of these things as being essentially the same thing. And that's a result of the fog of cultural dissonance, I think, is the best way to describe it.
Absolutely. And with, you know, with stuff like QAnon, it's dangerous because those narratives can be hijacked to control people's belief, you know.
And QAnon are always worried about mind control. They're under mind control.
Right.
They have succumbed to it. And right. Speaking of mind control, folks, this is an ideal tone to remind you three Dreamlanders that we also engage in mind control. And you're going to find out how powerful it is when you listen to these commercials and find yourself doing what we ask. We'll be right back.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing, he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today.
We're talking to David Metcalfe. His website is davidmetcalfe.wordpress. And you will find on that website many, many interesting things. Many interesting things. As a very interesting guy, the theme of this show is probably the saucers will keep their secrets, which is also the guiding principle of this lovely T-shirt that he has, has created. Anyway, here we are with the T-shirt. And you can see a nice picture of it if you go on his website. And I'm not really selling T-shirts. I just think it's really very cute. And I'm going to wear one, and I'm going to give one to my brother and probably my grandson. So anyway.
I appreciate that. And, you know, it's funny. I wasn't selling T-shirts either until the DNI report came out, the initial preliminary report, and I put that graphic up on Facebook, and a friend of mine said, oh, hey, are there T-shirts available? And I was like, no, but hang on one second. Let me see what I could do. And so yeah. I jumped on it, and John E.L. Tenney, actually, I looked at whatever T-shirt thing he was using for some of his stuff, because he's got some funny shirts like the Darrow Destroyer T-shirt, which is a nod to Richard Shaver. And so I figured if John was putting it out, the T-shirt quality was probably pretty okay. So I jumped on and put that out. And now I've discovered almost an obsessive enjoyment of making these graphics to put on T-shirts. It's just kind of a fun. It's a fun extension.
Well, it's enjoyable, and the T-shirt certainly is a classic, and perfect timing too, because as I said earlier, the one silent voice in all of this brouhaha as we go through yet another cycle of quote-unquote disclosure And there have been many before. This is only one of them. And this one's exceptionally, I think, absurd because of its, the attempt is being made to make it seem as if this all sort of started in 2004. And the media is always entirely clueless. Nobody looks anywhere, any depth. Nobody looks back to the hearings that took place in the 60s. They don't look back to the Disclosure Project. They don't look back to what happened in 1952. They don't look back to anything.
Right.
They just repeat what they've been told. But there is a difference, though, and this is something I'd like to talk about in a few minutes, because we have still got something else on our agenda that we have not gotten to, and we're going to get to it right now, which is your experiences. But then in a few minutes, let's talk about the possibility that there is some kind of, speaking of conspiracies, level of social control here that emerges from the phenomenon itself somehow, or from our relationship with it. First, let's go back to your youth, your misspent youth, reading alchemical texts at presumably the age of about 15.
Yeah.
And explore a little bit about your experiences that you've had in your life, your paranormal experiences.
Yeah, so my earliest experiences were living in a presumably haunted house in River Grove, Illinois. And it's interesting because I have two older brothers, both of whom experienced sort of poltergeist phenomena. And as a kid, I didn't know any of these stories, but I had experiences of my own in the house, including a really wonderful media synchronicity of waking up one night at like 2 in the morning, you know, and I'm like 5 or 6 years old. And I walk downstairs and my dad's fallen asleep with the TV on. And on the TV is Poltergeist, with the scene where the kid is walking up to the TV, right? So I wake up, go down the stairs, and am walking into the room just as the girl is going down the stairs and walking up to the TV. You know, it was this amazing moment of you know, interacting with media and synchronicities and that. And I think that probably definitely left a lasting impression on me in terms of how all these things sort of integrate together. You know, but there were some like apparitional kind of things that happened in that house. My brothers had poltergeist effects. Like I saw a guitar playing itself, things floating and that. It was a really odd kind of house to be in. And my family had history there. My great grandfather had actually built some of the houses in River Grove, and was a plumber there for a while. So it was a weird sort of thing. And I found out later, which is a great, I was reading Josh Cutchin, who you also is a Dreamland guest. I was reading Where the Footprints End, and there was actually a Bigfoot encounter that he mentions that Linda Gottfried had written about, which was in Schiller Park, which is right down the road from where I was at when I was a kid. You know, and this kind of stuff always sort of hovered around. You know, I always had an interest. My parents, you know, I had mentioned earlier them, you know, keeping the kid busy during the move and that. When we got to Arizona, one of the first Christmases there, they got me the Time Life book series, Mysteries of the Unknown, which
well,
was...
That was a wonderful series. I remember it very well. I got it too.
Yeah, and it was an incredible introduction to, you know, all sorts of stuff, including like Aleister Crowley is mentioned in some of it. The UFO one, the UFO phenomena, I think is the name of that edition in that series. That was great. And it was, you know, written from a very serious perspective of looking at this stuff. And so I got that when I was 7 or 8 or 9, and that really was my like, you know, I'd already had weird experiences as a kid, and that really kind of sealed the deal. And so once I got into high school, you know, because again, obviously with the bookstores and all that, like I really enjoyed reading everything I possibly could. And by the time I got into high school, I was already self-educating, you know? So in classes where the teachers would allow it, they allowed me to kind of explore that on my own, you know? And so that was where the reading up on alchemy at 14 or 15 came in, you know, and doing a report on that and studying it.
I went to a Catholic high school and I could do the work without working.
Right.
And so what I did was I played pranks and practical jokes for 4 years, and the principal hated me so much he almost could not speak in my presence because he had tried so hard to catch me for so long and had failed. And, oh, I used to do such devilish things to the man. I really worry that when I finally passed on across the bar, he's going to be standing there and say, "Now it's my turn." So you had these experiences, and there was a sense of something kind of at the edges of the world, and that maybe that's why you say in your website, exploring the outer edges of society and mind. And now you've done a very interesting piece on the site called Hypnotic Media and Deja Vu Analysis of Public Interest in Flying Saucers from 2004 to 2021. Now, my first question is, as soon as I saw that, before I even read it, was, why did you start with 2004? Because the media, because the government is starting with 2004?
Yeah, that and Google Trend only goes back to 2004 conveniently. So it was a nice convergence of factors. But 2004 specifically, from what you're saying, is that's when this report goes back to. So with the idea, for those of us who are interested in this topic, since 2017, it seems like this has exploded. And it's really easy to be in kind of an echo chamber. So my curiosity was, kind of peaked as, what is the public seeing? Because, media has a way of creating these artificial bubbles of interest. And I know, the current contemporary news cycle is very heavy in terms of, someone will write about it in a blog, it'll go from the blog topic, it'll get picked up by some like a web magazine like Vice, who have people scouring for trends, and then it'll get written up in Vice, and then CNN or New York Times or some larger entity, will more established entity, will pick it up from there and create a story out of it. And sometimes that can make it look like small trends are way bigger than they are. And so my question was how much of a bubble is this UFO thing in terms of public interest? And I was really surprised by what the Google Trend chart shows. And, from a data analytics, it's not the most robust way you can do this. It's not the most nuanced way you could study this, but it gives a good idea. And what the chart shows, I wrote that piece in May, and what the chart shows is that the public is not as interested as it would seem to be. And that that particular moment, it's changed a little bit now. The public has gotten a little bit more interested. There is a much higher peak now that the report's out, and it's really saturating the media with it. But when the New York Times piece came out in 2017, it was a smaller peak than it had been in all the other peaks in years since 2004. The largest peak, which was significantly larger than anything that had happened up to now, Post report was the Stephenville case. The Stephenville.
That's a really fascinating case. And I think the fact that it happened so close to the then Western White House, George W. Bush's branch, might have greatly increased public interest. But you know something interesting here, too, as a sidelight, Leslie Keen told me that their story, their 2017 story on UFOs, was by far one of the most read stories in the history of the Times.
Right.
But yeah, and so it didn't, you know, that's an isolated community because it's highly, you know, these are very affluent, mostly highly educated people that read the New York Times. And the general public, though, just has a different perspective.
Right. And that was, you know,
aren't they? They're used to the enigma.
Right. And that's what I think is interesting about looking at the public data, because the public aren't searching for it. So it doesn't have it doesn't have that integrated depth of, you know, this comes out and, oh, now suddenly people are like, oh, I've got to find out more. No one really wanted to find out more, you know. And what I think is interesting about the Stephenville case is, you know, what was different, at least from what I kind of saw in these different peaks that I highlight in that article or that blog post, is Angelia Joyner and local media and a real reporter going out into the community, talking to people and building up that conversation and that relationship with the topic and with the kind of weight of the topic. And I think that was the difference. Whereas now we have a lot of people that are talking about this in, you know, social media and that, but they're all branded as UFO people, or they're branded as investigative journalists or something, but they're not just a local reporter doing their job and kind of investigating this mystery. And I think that has a lot more weight with people in the general public than, you know, someone who is, you know, a UFO expert, or, you know, whatever the term the morning show puts on, you know, the person. And that's kind of the difference that I see. Now, it has since, so I wrote that in May, and then once when the report came out, I thought that I was going to have to eat my words and that there was going to be a huge surge. But there really hasn't been a huge surge. It is higher. Well, there is a peak. There's a definite peak in the data, but it hasn't been the huge kind of surge. And it just, I don't think that, you know, as we were talking about, and as you've talked about a lot prior to the report coming out and since the report coming out, it doesn't deal with the experiencer. You know, it doesn't deal with people's experiences. And, you know, you had pointed this out before the report came out in a subscriber special section, where you had talked about are the people who've experienced abductions and who have had contact, are they going to get thrown under the bus?
Right.
And I think that in looking at the, you know, I've done a lot of kind of pieces over the years looking at percentages of belief in the population, and in terms of what really amps people up, it is those personal experiences. It is that direct human element to it, the human element of the inhuman that makes, that draws the public interest. And I think that, you know, kind of just no matter how interesting the military encounters are to a certain extent, they don't have that depth of humanity to them, you know, the fighter pilot's personal experiences are in that.
We had an intelligence officer from the Roosevelt on, Matthew Roberts, and his experiences were really very much in the direction of the close encounter people, that was quite unusual. Military families and military people, in my experience, tend to have rather negative experiences. I know quite a few people in that area that have had negative experiences, and one or two that are on this website, one I've even interviewed on Dreamland, who have had extraordinary experiences. He was also an intelligence officer involved in the Navy in the submarine. He and his wife ended up on a UFO in a just incredibly vivid, extraordinary daylight experience. So that there's an involvement there, but you know, you can't expect, I don't think you can reasonably expect something that is being attacked to be nice to the attackers when they end up in the same space.
Right.
And unlikely. Now, by the way, Free Dreamlanders, I, to my great cost, missed my third and final effort to beg you to subscribe. So I'm begging you to subscribe. If you're still listening, if you're not still listening, you probably shouldn't subscribe because you're not interested enough in this stuff. Now, let's just go briefly back to the fate of Angela Joyner. She died in, it's Angelia, excuse me, Joyner. She died in 1960, died in 2021 and then was born in 1961. She had, after publishing that article in the Stevensville, in the Empire Tribune in Stevensville, she had a lot of trouble. She forced the Air Force to admit that their fighters had been in the area at the time. And I think they might have gotten after her.
Yeah,
the Air Force, I mean, not the fighters.
Her career definitely suffered. You know, I mean, she had to kind of start doing independent stuff because she got hooked. You know, she saw that there was something there. She saw that there was something to look into. And so she started pursuing it, you know, and that's the sad thing about this idea of sort of an official look at this or an official sanction to look at this is how many people have gone before. You know, James McDonald. I mean, you could list off so many people that have put their careers and, you know, their personal lives at risk to continue down this
road. And Paul Benowitz, who was done to death.
Right.
Many of us in the public, UFO people in the public space have had plenty of trouble with levels of social control or attempts at it, sort of ham-handed, most of them. But what's not ham-handed, I don't think, is the way the phenomenon appears to work in terms of control. I've cited this as a classic example. The Roswell incident, something unknown crashes 30 miles from the world's most sensitive military base, the 509th bomb wing, the only operational atomic bomb wing in the world, mm-hmm. at a time when its mere presence is probably the main thing keeping Stalin away from moving his armies all the way across Western Europe, because they are now halted at the Iron Curtain. And you have to wonder if they, why that, was that place chosen? What exactly happened? And you know, Diana, you know about the donation site,
mm-hmm.
Where all of these artifacts have been found over the years. It's not Roswell, and it's not a known site, actually, folks. And while I know where it is, I'm not going to be the one to break the news because I value my own peace. In any case, it's there. It's on private land anyway. And what could be going on that these things happen? That these sort of, you know, because Roswell, I know there were bodies at Roswell involved because General Exon, who personally handled them at Wright Field in his arms, told me they were there, and he was no liar. General Exon was he'd been the commanding officer at Wright Pat. He was a I don't, he may not have even known how alive. He was that type of guy.
Right.
So why is it like this? What are they doing? We would never, something crashing that close to this sensitive place is always going to end up buried in secrecy.
Right. Well, and I think that's what's so fascinating, especially with the nuclear angle, because I don't think people have, well, it's never been written, like the way that the Manhattan Project and that nuclear program has shaped culture in strange ways that people have no idea. You know, when I went to college, I went to college at what was Elmhurst College, and then it's now Elmhurst University, and they actually had a particle accelerator from the Manhattan Project, because a guy that worked at the University of Chicago had worked with Fermi, and he had a weird relationship where, as he didn't have a doctorate or anything, he just could do the work, right? And so he was a sort of lab technician guy. And once the stuff started getting decommissioned, he had worked with it. And so he started to, anything they wanted to throw out, he would take. And he happened to donate this particle accelerator to Elmhurst for their sort of physics program that was attached to one of, there's two national labs up there, Argonne and Fermi Lab. And, but the weird thing about this guy is he created, this lab that was offsite of University of Chicago. It was in a warehouse. And basically anything that the physics department and the science departments were throwing out, he would take. So if it was excess chemicals or whatever, he would take it. If it was a particle accelerator, he would take it. He happened to donate that to Elmhurst. But he created this open lab where anyone could come. The doors were always open. And anyone who had an experiment that they had the equipment for it could do it. Well, what come to find out, the guy who helped him move some of that stuff was Ed Edwards, who's one of the strongest PK subjects now. And Ed has been studied at the Rhine Center, and he has this strange relationship with the Manhattan Project through this guy, and I forget the guy's name, who created this open lab, right? And who Ed helped. But here's the thing. Ed attributes his psychokinetic abilities to a contact experience when he was 4 years old or 6 years old, right? So what does that say? You know, here's the Roswell incident, which happens super close to, you know, like you said, the bomber unit. Here's Ed Edwards, who's now one of the most public and strongest psychokinetic, you know, experiencers, someone who's lab tested, verified, capable of doing psychokinesis on command. He attributes his experience to a contact, his abilities to a contact experience, but also has this connection to, you know, this guy who worked with Fermi and had this weird sort of open lab, you know, and there's this strange connection to that moves through this, you know, and it just keeps popping up. One of the von Karman, one of the scientists who worked on the Manhattan Project, von Karman was a descendant of the rabbi in the Golem story, the Prague Golem. Von Karman was a relative, you know, a distant relative of his. You've got Jack Parsons, right? Who had
Jack Parsons.
Yeah.
We have reached the end of one part of our show. The Free Dreamlanders. It's time to sign off. And in the next half hour, we're going to be talking more about the threat assessment and what it means and doesn't mean. And will the saucers always keep their secrets? Free Dreamlanders, thank you very much for listening. Subscribers will keep right on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.